Well, good morning. This is our service on the Lord's Day to worship God together. It's good to see you all. The 21. We'll read the first 16 verses of Job 21. This is God's word. Then Job answered and said, "Listen carefully to my speech, and let this be your consolation. Bear with me, that I may speak, and after I've spoken, keep mocking. As for me, is my complaint against man? And if it were, why should I not be impatient? Look at me and be astonished. Put your hand over your mouth. Even when I remember, I'm terrified, and trembling takes hold of my flesh. Why do the wicked live and become old? Yes, become mighty in power. Their descendants are established with them in their sight, and their offspring before their eyes. Their houses are safe from fear, neither is the rod of God upon them. Their bull breeds without failure, their cow calves without miscarriage. They send forth their little ones like a flock, and their children dance. They sing to the tambourine and harp, and rejoice to the sound of the flute. They spend their days in wealth, and in a moment go down to the grave. Yet they say to God, 'Depart from us, for we do not desire the knowledge of your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? And what profit do we have if we pray to him? Indeed, their prosperity is not in their hand. The counsel of the wicked is far from me.'" Well, that's quite an unusual passage of God's word. We don't read often from the book of Job, but we do look to the Lord to speak to us and to bless us this morning. So we thank God for his word. Now then, if you've got a Bible, please turn to Job and chapter 21. Life isn't as straightforward as we sometimes think. And because of that, it's possible to make massive mistakes in life, particularly mistakes about life itself and mistakes about God, mistakes that really matter. And that principle, that life isn't as straightforward as we sometimes think, that's one of the great lessons of the book of Job. Now, in this passage, Job chapter 21, what I want us to do is look at two massive mistakes made by two different groups of people. The first is the mistake of Job's religious friends, okay? And the second one is the mistake of those who have no time for God, that the passage is about, and that are referred to in verses 14 and 15. I wonder where you are this morning, everyone who's watching this. Perhaps you have a belief or a religious practice, but you find that as you go on in that path, if you stop back and look at yourself and you're honest, it tends to make you a bit critical of other people. And it leaves you a little bit uneasy, feeling that maybe that's not quite right. Or it may be that Christianity has no real place in your life. Maybe there's some lip service, but in your heart of hearts, not really. Or perhaps some people watching this are even quite deliberately set against it. Well, when life is good and things are great, you may feel that in that situation, if you were to become a Christian and take the Bible seriously, it wouldn't help. All it would do is actually make your life worse. But if that's the case, what I hope is that you'll bear with us as we work through this passage and see what it is that this passage has to say to us about the massive mistake that it is to think that life is better when we exclude God from it. So we'll pick it up in order, and we'll start off with the mistake of Job's religious friends. Now, we don't need to go into this in a lot of detail, but those of you who've got any familiarity with the book of Job will know that the big problem of Job's religious friends was they thought that God punished sin in this life. You know the expression, you're a real Job's comforter. They tried, or they thought, that by coming to him and talking to him, they were helping him. But in fact, they only made the situation worse. And the reason is their view of what God does in the world was far too narrow and far too black and white. Job himself was a man who believed in God, who trusted him for salvation, who loved him, and who sought to serve him faithfully in his life. That's the reality of his life. But his life took a tragic and a painful turn. He lost his health and his wealth and his home and his family, and he didn't know why. But his three friends, Zophar, Bildad and Eliphaz, they came to him and they knew why, so they told him why. When bad things happen in your life, it's because God is judging you for sin. And if something really bad has happened, then obviously that means that you must have sinned really badly. Job's comfort us. But the problem is, you see, that's quite a common view amongst religious people. We see it in the Jews of Jesus' day in John chapter 9. We read there, they see a man born blind, and Jesus' disciples ask him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" You see the point? Tragedy in his life, it must be because of his sin. And they draw a straight line. God punishes sin in this world. If anything goes wrong, it's because God is out to get you. But you see, it's not just obviously religious people who think like that. It's actually a very, very widespread idea. You know the idea of karma? What goes around comes around? If I do good, good will come. And if I do bad, bad will come. Well, that's the same idea. The way you live in the world, it determines what happens to you in life. If you do good, you get good. If you do bad, you get bad. But the problem with that sort of view is, fundamentally, it's just wrong. And think about the effects that it has on people. When people think like that, they can make them judgmental and lacking in compassion. And that was true of Job's friends. As far as they were concerned, Job had just got what he deserved. And the way that they speak to him is just cruel on occasions in the book of Job. But also, if people think like that, then when things do go wrong in life, in our lives, it can make us hard and bitter. And we can come to blame God rather than letting the trouble point us to our need of a Savior who is a shelter, who's bigger than our problems, and who's able to help us in the midst of the storms of life. Now, it's important that we're honest about these things, and the book of Job is a brutally honest book. Afflictions don't drive people to God on their own. Afflictions can make you hard, or afflictions can soften you. But they only soften us if God is at work in our hearts, and if we realize that these things are a call to trust in God, who is bigger than the difficulties of life. But that's the issue here with these religious people. They think that God punishes sin in this life, and if bad stuff happens to you, it's because you've done bad things. In the few chapters just before chapter 21, Job's friends are speaking to him, and they tell him this. And they specifically tell him, look, when people live wicked lives, all sorts of bad stuff happens. And so in chapter 21, Job has to challenge that. He says, look, the problem with your view is it's just not true. Sometimes the righteous suffer. And that was Job's experience. He didn't understand why he was suffering. But he was aware that there was no specific sin or disobedience involved, as far as he could possibly tell. And that's the reality in the lives of many righteous people. Suffering comes for no specific sinful reason. Sometimes, as in the case of Job himself, the reason is just hidden in the secret will and purpose of God. We know why Job suffered. We are told in the first chapters. Job didn't know that, and neither did his friends. Job, in that sense, was in the dark. But this suffering came to a righteous man. The reality is, rather than the Christian life being a life free from trouble, the reality is that we are subject to the same problems and the same difficulties in life as everybody else. And in addition to that, sometimes there are extra problems. Because the devil loves to attack those who are faithful to Christ, as we see in the first chapter of the book of Job. And after all, it's through many tribulations that we have to enter the kingdom of God. So that idea is that bad things happen because people are bad and God is punishing them. It's just plain wrong. Okay? The second thing Job points out in chapter 21 is sometimes the wicked prosper. Now, his friends had stressed how God catches up with the wicked in life. He shortens their lives and he fills them with sorrow. You can read chapter 20, for instance, and you get a lot of that. But Job points out it just isn't true. And particularly in the section from verse 7 and following in chapter 21, Job challenges some of this. He says, look, you've said that the wicked people will die childless. And remember, in the Old Testament, having a child was a sign of honor. You've said that they'll die childless. Well, in chapter 18 and verse 19, for instance, he has neither son nor posterity among his people, nor any remaining in his dwellings. God will snuff out his family line. Job says, look around. That's just not true. Verse 8. Their descendants are established with them in their sight, and they are offspring before their eyes. Their families are strong and healthy. What you're saying is not true. His friends had said, God catches up with people in life, and the wicked die young. But Job says in verse 11, his bones are full of his youthful vigor. It'll lie down with him in the dust. Youthful vigor. See, it's not true. Why do the wicked live and become old and mighty in power? That's what Job says in verse 7. Why do the wicked live and become old? You say they're supposed to die when they're young. They don't. And then he lists so many other problems. He says in verse 10, their businesses prosper. You know, their animals are fruitful. He says in verse 12, they enjoy life. In verse 13, they're prosperous. And then in verse 13, he says, and they die suddenly without pain or fear. They live a prosperous, healthy life. And then they pass from this world to the grave in a moment. I think it's true to say that a lot of people struggle with this. But it's just a fact. We can see war criminals and we can see violent crime bosses living out their lives in luxury and comfort. And we struggle to understand why it is that God allows it and why it is that there seems to be no justice. Asaph, he wrote Psalm 73 and he struggled with that. He said, my feet had almost stumbled and my steps had nearly slipped because I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. There are no pangs in their death. Their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, nor plagued like other men. He says, my life's been tough, but their life seems to be full of the joys of spring. I just don't understand it. Job's friends had a very simple idea of life. You do bad, you get bad. You do good, you get good. But Job says, it's just not true to facts. There are bigger things than that going on in the world. Now, what are we to make of this? Well, I think we need to focus on the mistake that they are making. When people fall into that trap, it's really because their view of God and their view of life and their view of justice is far too narrow and far too limited. And they fail to understand at least three things. Okay? The first one is eternity. Now, there's no lack of justice with God. But we have to realize that our existence consists of far more than this life, even if it's a long and healthy one. The reality is, after death, we all go to stand before God in judgment and we face eternity. And that means that for those who have been forgiven through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, they'll be received into the presence of God. He will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and then he will enable us to understand the things that we couldn't understand in the difficulties of the here and now. There's a bigger game than just what we can see going on around us. But the flip side of that is, those who die unrepentant and without Christ, however pleasant and long their lives might have been, when they come to stand before God, they will face justice. And God will inevitably cast them away from his presence into everlasting punishment. Now that truth about eternity is the thing that helped Asaph in Psalm 73. He says there in verses 16 and 17, when I tried to understand, it was too painful for me. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their end. I realized God is bigger than just the things I can see, and life is bigger than these 70 years or so. And God is over it all. And whatever may happen in this world that I don't understand, God is in the end game. And finally, everything will be made right. Eternity. Now, the issue there is that if our religion is so focused on this world and this life that we just can't get to grips with the fact that wicked people might live a good life and righteous people might live a tough life, what we have to do is step back and remember eternity. There is far, far more at play. Finally, God will bring everyone to judgment. And those who've been faithful to him, like Daniel's friends, and like the martyrs of old, and like individual Christians or in their own quiet circles of life, have had to stand in the face of mockery sometimes, stand in the face of family opposition, stand in the face of personal weakness and hardship. The Lord himself will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Eternity. The second thing, they don't understand the patience of God. This is an important theme in Scripture. One of the reasons why the Lord withholds judgment from wicked men in this life is because he's displaying his patience. In 2 Peter 3, the Lord isn't slack concerning his promise, the promise of the return of Christ in judgment, as some people count slackness. It's not that he's forgotten. Rather, he is long-suffering towards us. What does that mean? Why is he long-suffering? Why does he give us time and put up with it? Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Now think about it. If God were to step in this life every time with perfect justice, that would be the end of the mass murderers, wouldn't it? Okay, what about the violent people out for a drink and a fight on a Saturday night? What about the adulterers? What about the thieves? What about the people who cause the collapse of businesses and rob pension funds? What about the people who shoplift in Debenhams just before he closes? What about us with our own hatreds and our own fears? What about us? If God were to step in perfect judgment, surely it would all be over. But God displays his patience and his long-suffering so that the really evil and the people like us who are wicked in our own way might have opportunity to come to repentance. Job's friends lacked compassion, true. But they also lacked a sense of the seriousness of sin. Otherwise, why were they so concerned about that and less concerned about this? Thank God he doesn't lack compassion and he doesn't lack patience, but he bears with us, wicked as we are, that we might have opportunity to repent. Eternity, the patience of God, the character of true blessing. They seem to think that if you do good, you get good in life, and that's what blessing is all about. If you do bad, you get bad in life, and that's what judgment is all about. But they don't understand the character of real blessing, what it really means to be blessed by God. For instance, they don't seem to understand forgiveness. And the reason I say that is this. The Bible's teaching on what's called justification is that when, by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven and we are accepted by God because of his righteousness and his work on the cross, What that means is there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. And if that's true, whatever happened to righteous Job in his life, God isn't judging him for his sins because he hates him and he's trying to destroy him. That isn't what is happening. And it's as if they can't see that and they can't grasp it. They don't realize that if Job suffers in this life, it might still be true that he's a child of God who loves him and who serves him. And he doesn't understand why God is doing this to him, but however hard his life might be, his soul is safe with God and his sins are forgiven, and he can call the one who is over all in the difficulties of his life, Father. And he can have confidence that he'll never leave him nor forsake him. When there's too much focus on the outward and the physical and the money and the health, I think we have to question whether we really understand true spiritual blessings. What it means to be a child of God and forgiven but in a hospital bed. Or what it means to belong to the Father but to be destitute and homeless. What it means in some parts of the world to be so poor that we're not even able to help our own families. And yet to be rich in Christ Jesus. Because this is a circumstance that we don't understand. But there's something far, far bigger at play. You notice with his friends, they talk a lot about God, but they never talk to God. It's as if they don't realize that the Lord is worth trusting and the Lord is worth loving, even in the darkness. But Job knows that, because he says, I know that my Redeemer lives. Isn't it true that he that finds Christ finds a pearl of great price, even though everything else in life might be difficult? So those are some issues there relating to Job's friends and the big mistake of such religious people who seem to think it's all about this world. And they forget eternity. They forget the patience of God. And they don't understand what it really means to be blessed. The second thing, more quickly, the mistake of the irreligious people, which brings us to verses 14 and 15. You see, Job's friends had said, God will judge the wicked in this life. They were wrong. That doesn't always happen. The wicked themselves, they've got a very different view of life. They don't think that God plays any part in their life at all. Look at verses 14 and 15. They say to God, depart from us. We don't desire the knowledge of your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? And what profit do we have if we pray to him? In their view, life is better without God. Because life's going well for them. Their families are happy. Their businesses are successful. Their health is good. Everything is positive. And they're pretty satisfied. And when it came to considering God, they said three things. Verse 14, I'm not interested. Depart from us, for we do not desire the knowledge of your ways. I'm not interested. I'm not interested in knowing the truth. It always strikes me as fascinating that there are people who have got interest in 1,001 things. They can tell you about car mechanics and antique clocks. They can tell you the names of all the plants in the garden. They know loads about history. They know about cookery. And they haven't got the slightest clue about the Bible. I remember watching an episode of University Challenge years ago. Don't do that very often. Technical scientific questions. Either I'm too old, I don't know that. And then there was a question which was something like, can you name the four people who wrote the Gospels? Not a clue. Not a clue. Why is that? See, there are people who will be offered a tract in the street or invited to a church service and they'll just refuse. Or if a conversation starts and something is said about the gospel, their disinterest and even their annoyance is quickly seen. You can see depart from us written all over their faces. And I think it's possible that tomorrow at the market stall in town, some of the people who pass by and refuse fall into this category. No, not in my life. Depart from me, I do not desire the knowledge of your ways. No interest. But also, no interest in living a holy and a righteous life. Because this idea of knowledge of your ways, it's not just knowledge about your ways, but it's knowing how to do that. It's practical knowledge. I don't want to live like that. I hear that Christians go to church and sing songs and read the Bible and pray for one another and spend their lives doing good and try to stop doing bad things. Not interested in that. If I had to live my life like that and give up the stuff I love, it would only make me sadder and poorer and madder. If I was to do that, I would lose out. Can you see that? Depart from me. No interest in those things. It would make my life worse to become a Christian. No interest in Christ and the gospel. And often it's at that point that the character of people who are not interested in God and think that God would only make their lives worse is more clearly revealed. You see, the Christian life has no attraction because that would only make me sad having to live like that. Yeah. But the gospel has got no attraction because all this talk about sin and repentance and forgiveness and needing a savior, it just leaves me uncomfortable. I don't see myself as that sort of person, and I wish you'd stop talking about it. That's the first situation. Verse 14, I've got no interest. Second situation, verse 15, I'm under no obligation. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? What's it to me? There's a bit of irony there, isn't there? Because they call God the Almighty and yet think he's got no claim on him. It's the same thing with Pharaoh. Exodus 5, Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I don't know the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Nebuchadnezzar was the same. But it's not just kings and rulers. The same attitude is present wherever people think that they're in control. They are free to live their lives as they please, and they're not answerable to God. And one of the most striking ways that this shows itself today, I feel, is this. People seem to think that they have a right to decide whether or not God should have any place in their lives and any influence upon them. It's for them to decide whether or not the Almighty has any role to play in their lives and whether or not they are in any sense answerable to him. And it's ridiculous. It's like somebody saying, you know, I'm born in this particular country, we live under the rule of law, but the laws only apply to me if I agree with them. It's just not true. They apply to us whether we agree with them or not. And God is God. And we are still responsible to him, whether we agree with him or not. I'm under no obligation, I say. And then the third thing, I'd be no better off. What profit do we have if we pray to him? That's very sad, really. But you come across it, I find, quite often. People think that God, the God who made the world and sustains it all, the God who has done remarkable things, this God of beauty and of majesty and of wisdom and of richness, this God could contribute nothing to their lives. What profit would there be if I pray to him? What could he give me to make my life better that I don't already have? I can't see that any of his ways would help me out at all. And that can either be because they think God's not willing to help, or they think that God's not able to help, or it might just be because they think nothing that God could do could make their lives any better anyway. You know, it's easy to think like that when things are going well, isn't it? It's not so easy when there are problems. So that's the mistake here, thinking that life would be better without God. God would only make our lives worse. But the problem with it, It's not true. It misunderstands life, and it misunderstands God. Let me just give you a few things. We are just creatures. When they say, who is the Almighty that we should serve him? Well, he's a God who made us. And if he's the God who made us and has given us life, then we are obligated to him. We're obligated to love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Because we are just creatures. We are not God. And we have to view life in the light of eternity. We might dismiss God, but we can't avoid God. And one day, he'll bring us all into judgment. And what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? We have to remember as well, when God speaks, we have to take his word seriously. And God commands all men everywhere to repent. And for somebody to say, I know that God calls on me to repent, to turn from my sin and to come to him for mercy and to trust Christ for salvation, but I don't fancy it, thanks very much. Depart from me, not interested. It's a very unhealthy position to be in, isn't it? To respond to God in that kind of way. And as we read in Hebrews, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? The truth is that the blessings of God do make life better. It's possible to live like a king, but to be in massive debt. All the flash cars and everything else, they're all done on credit, you know. And all you've got to do is prick the bubble, and it all falls apart. People can look rich, but in fact, they can be bankrupt. And that's the situation of the people in chapter 21. Yeah, they got long life. Their families are healthy. They're doing well. But it's all external and it's all show. What real riches have they got on the inside? What real substantial deep blessings have they got that really makes life worthwhile? That really sets them up for eternity? That really means that they are where they should be as regards their relationship with the only true and living God? What about forgiveness? Forgiveness is something money can't buy. It's secured through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, a lamb with blood more precious than silver or gold. What about acceptance? Money might be able to buy your way into the red carpet, but money can't buy your way into the presence of God. And what does money do for you when the storm is blowing? To know then that God is our Father, and we might be bedraggled, and we might be windswept, and we might be soaked to the skin. But he's our Father still, and he loves us. And it makes no difference at all. It means a new heart, doesn't it? You know, true blessing is not riches on the outside, but riches on the inside. Paul says the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. It's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. It means being rich in good works. It means loving the Lord our God, even in the storm, just like Job did, a man who was truly rich before God. It means fellowship with God, to know that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, and to know sometimes, as we read in Job 35, he's the God who even gives songs in the night. It's interesting, if you speak to Christian people who've been through long periods of difficulty and of pain, they'll often remember certain occasions where God in his mercy drew very near and comforted them in a very special way. Because in all our affliction, he's our gentle and compassionate Father still. It means hope beyond the grave. See, ultimately, we're just strangers and pilgrims here. But as Christians, we look for a city with foundations whose builder and maker is God. And Paul understood this, and he'd thought it out, and he'd come to a firm conclusion in Romans chapter 8. I've thought about this and I've come to this conclusion. I consider that the sufferings of this present time and not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. See, they got it wrong. God couldn't possibly make my life better. I'm not interested in him anyway. And I don't see any point in praying, because what could God possibly do for me? Everything. He could change your heart and set you free. He could remove the scales and take the blindness away so you realize there's more to life than the stuff you've got. He could give you a sense of eternity. He could make you realize how selfish it is to try and live for yourself and to neglect the God who made you and the Savior who died so that there might be a way of salvation for you. And in his mercy, through the Lord Jesus Christ, he can come and he can wash you clean. And he can give you an inheritance in heaven, incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved even for you. So how can we get there? And how can such irreligious people be changed? Well, to go from the situation in verse 14, depart from us, we do not desire the knowledge of your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? What profit do we have if we pray to him? They need a complete change, don't they? A complete change in outlook. They need to be turned into people who love the Lord Jesus Christ and who love the gospel, who desire to walk in his ways, who recognize that they're not their own because they've been bought with a price, who know that they have a Father in heaven who loves them and who hears their prayers. How does that happen? They need to be converted. They need to be changed. God needs to come and to step into the situation, because what is impossible with men is possible with God. Remember in Luke's gospel, a rich man, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to be saved. Who then can be saved, say the disciples? Well, what's impossible with men is possible with God. They're loving life and they don't want anything to change, and they don't want God to have anything to do with them. How is that going to be broken down? God can come and change a heart. God can come and speak a word. God can come and bring conviction. God can come and open eyes. And then God can come and reveal his glory in the face of Jesus Christ. And he can win our hearts to turn from our sins and trust him. And he can give the assurance that we have a Father in heaven. And he can change it all. So this morning, my desire is just that. What profit do we have if we pray to him? Draw near to God and he'll draw near to you. This poor man called and the Lord heard him and delivered him out of all his trouble. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to Christ and ask Christ for his help. And the truth is that whoever comes to him, he will by no means cast out. Well, let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who understands us, the one who has come into the world and was made poor, so that through his poverty we might be made rich. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us today, and we pray that you'd help us to understand that it is in the Lord Jesus Christ alone that there's not just comfort and support and help through the difficulties of this world, but there's forgiveness and a true relationship with you and an eternity which is safe and is spent in your presence. We praise you for this, Lord. Hear us now. Accept our thanksgiving, we ask, in his great name. Amen.